Hi friends, Lorelei Black here from Blade and Broom, and today I'm going to share with you 16 tips plus one for camping festivals, pagan camping festivals specifically. I've seen festivals from every angle, just absolutely every way that you could experience festival, I've experienced it. So I have some thoughts on how to make best use of your experience, you know, how to get the most out of it. So I'd like to share those thoughts with you. So my 16 tips plus one are like this. Number one, the plus one is read the website. Oh my God, read the website. There's so much information there, and you would be shocked how many people come to the event or send the organizers questions that are right on the website. So read the website. Just start there. There's so much information there about what the event's about, what its purpose is, what kind of experience you're going to have, what the culture of the event is like. You know, you're probably going to find pictures, although some events don't post pictures because they're respecting people's privacy boundaries and that kind of thing. But, you know, you're going to get a real feel for what the culture of this entire little world within a world is like. So start with the website. And then we'll get into our 16 tips. So from here on out, it's kind of a free for all. It's just sort of how the thoughts came to me. When you get there, number one, choose your camping space with as much care as you possibly can. Understand what your own needs are and what your preferences are. And then pick a space to the best of your ability. You know, it may be crowded, but pick a space that's going to meet those needs. You know, if you don't like a lot of noise, do not set up next to where the bonfire is. It's going to be really noisy there. There's going to be a lot of drumming at night, probably, most likely. It's going to keep you awake. And they're not going to turn it down for you just because you're an early riser. There is no turning down the drumming at night. It's just going to be loud. So if you are going to, you know, burst into flames in the sun, try to get a shady spot if you can. If you need access to electric because of medical concern, you know, talk to an event coordinator or facilitator or somebody as you're checking in, or even hopefully before you get there, to see, you know, if there's medical considerations that you can take advantage of so that you can get the best possible spot for you. Number two, know the rules and laws of the land, of the state, of the festival before you arrive. Those are going to vary pretty widely, and you want to know what you're getting into, especially in terms of things like weapons, alcohol, drugs, photo and video. Some of these things you may not have thought of before. Other things are sort of basic camping FYIs, right? So things like, what do some of the plants look like that you might want to know about if you're not a big camper or you're not a big outdoorsy person and you have decided to join the festival scene? What does poison ivy look like? Do you know? Are you camping in it? Are you sitting in it? Have you decided to, you know, pop a squat right in a nest of poison ivy or poison oak or poison sumac? You do not want to get your crash course in herbalism the hard way. Bugs, especially, so a lot of people go camping in an area that's maybe not familiar with them. They've traveled to a whole other state and are dismayed to discover that Indiana has a lot of ticks, for instance, or, you know, mosquitoes are a thing in the Midwest or in the South. Not only are they irritating, but they also, you know, they carry West Nile. You want to protect yourself from these critters by, you know, using the sprays and all that kind of stuff. You also want to do frequent checks to make sure that you're not having ticks on you and that kind of thing, because these can be problems. And if you're going somewhere in other areas, you want to make sure that you know what the pest populations are there and how to avoid getting them on you. Same thing with other kinds of beasties. So I live here in the Midwest, in the Mid-South. We're most likely to have things like raccoons, which are, you know, trash pandas getting into our campsites, and then the occasional snake, but they mostly stay away during big festivals. But when I lived in California, we had bears and rattlesnakes though were the issue, which frankly freaked me out. So, you need to know what the non-human festival attendees might be and how you're going to protect your food and your campsite from them. You know, on point number six, you want to take some thought about companions. You don't have to go to a festival with a friend, but it's a lot easier and a little bit more fun when you do. But it's a lot easier to set up camp and tear down camp if you've got somebody with you. Make sure that you have a conversation about how you're going to divide up those duties. It will make life a lot easier. The festival can, especially depending on the kind of festival that you're going to, can put you into some different headspace than you're normally in. It is a very magical environment, and in that sense, it can be like being in ritual all weekend or all week, depending on how long the festival is. Can be very intense ritual spaces where you're really pushing yourself to try new things, to try, you know, to experiment ritually, to experiment with your sort of your psychic spaces and your boundaries and that type of thing. Like, I didn't sleep for 3 days and I was just sort of like thrumming with the power of what it was. And it really changed my headspace. And that was, you know, without touching a drop of liquor or anything like that, that was just an energetic shift that happened. So just be aware and touch in with your buddy. I highly recommend you bring one because it can really, really help to have that person there with you to help you ground and work through any issues that may come up for you. So point number seven, or tip number seven, is work shifts. It does kind of actually go hand in hand with some of the things that I was saying in the last one. Some festivals require that you have work shifts. Some don't, but you might have signed up for them because some festivals allow you to take on work shifts in order to lower the cost of your festival admission. If you have work shifts, or if you're required to have work shifts, make sure that you show up for them and that you do them. The festival is actually really counting on you to do that. If you've signed up for them, or if it's just part and parcel of your festival experience, the show doesn't work without the workers. Like, it needs it. So in the same way that a festival has to have people paying to attend so that the bills get paid, it has to have the hands doing the work to make sure that trash gets picked up, meals get made, brochures get handed out, you know, so information's getting to the people when they need it, water's getting delivered to presenters so that they don't get dehydrated. Just, you know, 100 things have to happen in order to make, more than 100 things, 1,000 things, 1,000,000 things have to happen to be able to make a festival run. Make sure you show up when you say you're going to show up. It's part of the magical contract you made. So do it. So tip number eight, one of the things that's sometimes built into certain festivals, not all festivals, but some of them. Cat. Cat that's freaking out. Is that there are psyche stations, sometimes under different names, at a lot of different festivals. And then something that's built into all festivals, or some kind of first aid station. So whatever the case, you want to know where that first aid station is. And if there's a psyche station, you want to know where it is. So the first aid station is pretty self-explanatory. Security station is pretty self-explanatory. These are sort of basic self-care places that if you need them, you want to know where to go. Locate them on your first day, please. The psyche station is also about self-care. And as I mentioned in one of the earlier tips, sometimes you're going to get into an energetic place where you're just going to need some extra grounding, and you may be able to do that on your own just fine. In the event that you're not, do not hesitate to go to that psyche station, or that grounding and centering tent, or that healing place, whatever it is that they're calling it. make use of it if you need it, okay? That mental health first aid. If you need it, go. So number 9 is packing tips. Some festivals are really good about putting this out there for you. If the festival you're attending doesn't have one, feel free to make use of the one that's available at campmidian.com. That's campmidian.com or at babylonrising.com. Babalon rising.com. They're very similar lists, but they're going to give you a basic camping and festival experience kind of pack list. Okay. So, and they're just sort of general ideas. I'm going to give you a couple of tips about that or a couple of hints. One is that we have found that, and this we is me and my husband, have found that packing in plastic tubs keeps your stuff safe from critters and from rain if you happen to get caught in a deluge. You want to pack clothing for all kinds of weather, wet, dry, hot, cold, everything. Have something in there that you can wear in every possible foreseeable outcome. Pack your own shade and pack your own wind. So canopies, have some canopies on hand, have a fan of some kind. Those little battery operated fans are nice. You can just take those with you. I like to have an umbrella that I use because it takes like some shade around with me, and then it also keeps me dry if it happens to rain. You can probably tell I burst into flame in the sun. So yeah, pack your own shade, pack your own wind. Cots don't deflate like air mattresses do. So if you have not yet bought something to sleep on, get yourself a cot instead of an air mattress. You can get those foam things to put on top of them. It's pretty comfortable. Tip number 10, know your emergency contacts. Make sure that your family has ways to get in touch with you. Give them the phone numbers for the land. Give them the phone numbers for your camping buddy. And then also make sure that you know how to get a hold of people. And if you have a serious medical condition, make sure that somebody knows your camping buddy. Tip number 11, please don't be just a pile of garbage. That sounds really bad. Leave the place cleaner than you found it, right? Don't leave your cigarette butts. That's so gross. So somebody's got to come up behind you and clean it up. And it's probably somebody that you met at that festival. Or if not, it's somebody that was sitting next to them. Pick up after yourself. Be a good citizen of the camp life. And just, you know, take that, what is it, a Girl Scout rule? Leave it better than you found it. Tip number 12. Give yourself some time to attune to the land. Just kind of like, don't jump out of your car, unpack, and then just immediately start jumping in and like try and interact with people. You are going to be a jangle of nerves and it's going to come across. So give yourself a moment to like check in, all that kind of stuff. Tune in, ground and center before you start interacting. Sort of watch people, see what the vibe is like. And then jump in. 13, find out what the kids programs are like, find out what the policies and places are for kids stuff, and take a shift volunteering if you've got kids that are going to be involved in that. Number 14, remember about touch taboos. If it's not yours, don't touch it unless there's enthusiastic consent. And that goes for bodies, that goes for tools, that goes for instruments, that goes for food. If it does not belong to you, don't touch it unless you are invited enthusiastically to do so. Number 15, the fire is always sacred. So usually there's going to be some kind of bonfire or central fire. You can do pretty much what you need to do with your own campfire. But that central fire is going to be a place where there's going to be drumming, there's going to be chanting, there's going to be singing. Sometimes there's going to be dancing around it. That is not a place for you to burn your trash. That is not a place, you know, for those kinds of profane things, right? So treat it with respect. Ask before you do anything to it, including even throwing wood into it. So in a lot of places, there are designated people who do that, and you want to make sure that you're using the right procedure You might not be allowed to touch that fire for reasons of safety or just for reasons of the traditions or cultures of that place. So, and it's not out of disrespect for you, it's out of respect to sort of the cultural norms of that land or of that festival. Whether it seems like it or not, you're in a ritual space, you're in a ritual container the whole time. So you are learning the rules of that ritual space and want to interact with them as gracefully as you can. And then the last point, number 16, that I want to make is, and I kind of touched on it earlier, is this idea that that there are naked pagans sometimes at a lot of festivals. So not all festivals allow nudity. Some allow partial nudity. Some are fully clothing optional, and some that's just not the norm, or that's just not something that's allowed depending on the rules of either the space or that event. So again, this is something that may be covered on the website, and that you'll be able to get an idea of whether or not that's going to be allowed before you get there. And maybe it's not, because maybe it's just an assumption of a freedom that the entire community already knows. And so you're going to get there and you're going to see fully nude people walking around, and maybe you weren't necessarily prepared for that. But I'm telling you to be prepared that that may be a thing that's happening. And if you're bringing kids with you, prepare them that that's a thing that could be happening. And then again, maybe it's not a thing that will be happening. Things that are not okay in regards to this. It's never okay, again, to touch somebody who is, it's never okay to touch somebody without their consent, whether they're clothed or not clothed. So no touchy unless you're invited enthusiastically to do so. It's also not okay to gawk at them, you know, to stare at them, or to really comment on their nudity. Just because they're naked doesn't mean that they're asking you to look at them. It's just a state in which they're comfortable. It's just how they chose to be that day. So they're not necessarily trying to flaunt their body for your observation. They just felt more comfortable in that particular state. So they're not asking for a date. They're not asking for your approval. It's not really about you. So it's about them. Don't be so shocked by it, I guess. It may still be jarring if it's not something that you've ever experienced before, but trust me, by the end of the weekend or the end of the week, you're going to leave that environment and go back to mundania and kind of be like, why are all these people wearing their clothes? It's like, you know, it's like they're wearing a mask over their faces and I can't really see who they are anymore. It's going to feel like a costume that people are wearing clothes again. Clothes just start to look weird. So those are my 16 plus one tips. I hope you found them useful. I know they ran a little long, but magical space, you know, when you're immersed in it like that, is such a different experience and such a different world that I think sometimes a little heads up or a little prep can be kind of useful. So that's all I got for you on this one. I hope that you found these ideas useful, the 16 plus one festival tips. And let me know what you think in the comments. If you have extra ideas to share based on your festival experiences, put them in those comments and let me know. Subscribe, like, share, do all the things, and I'll see you next week, Monday at noon. Bye, guys.